Hello, everyone. Welcome to our Learning and Legacy event. My name is Paul Seaman, and I'm a partner here at Gowling WLG in Vancouver. I'm also the national leader of our Indigenous Law Group and a Métis person. It's wonderful to see so many people join us today virtually to commemorate Canada's first National Day for Truth and Reconciliation. But before we begin, I want to acknowledge that I'm speaking to you from the unceded territories of the Coast Salish peoples, the Tsleil-Waututh, Squamish, and Musqueam nations. Because everyone joining us virtually today is based in different cities and provinces across Canada, we're all located in different Indigenous territories. So I encourage everyone joining us today to take a moment to reflect and acknowledge the Indigenous land on which you're living and working wherever you happen to be. We've gathered in person here today in Vancouver because of the sensitive nature of what we're about to discuss, as well as the practical fact that our internet connection here in the Gowling WLG office is much more reliable than our home offices. We are, of course, observing COVID-19 protocols and we're positioned 6 feet apart. But I also want to say a few words about today's program. In putting together today's webinar, I spoke with a number of Indigenous clients and colleagues and went back and reflected on the Truth and Reconciliation Commission's Calls to Action number 80 and 92. Call to Action number 80 calls for the recognition of today, not only just as a day, but calls on us to honor survivors, their families and communities, and ensure that the public commemoration of the history and legacy of residential schools remains a vital component of the reconciliation process. Call to Action number 92 calls upon the corporate sector to provide education for management and staff on the history of Indigenous peoples, including the history and legacy of residential schools. And reaching to meet these calls to action is exactly what we aim to do gathered here today. Now, let me introduce our two speakers, both of whom we are very honored to have with us here today. Our first guest is David Lugie. David is a member of the Stalatin First Nation and is a former elected chief. He's also a previous tribal chief of the Karisikani Tribal Council. David has worked as the administrator for other First Nations, including the Lake Babine Nation and the Natalie Wuten First Nation, and he currently serves as a senior advisor to the Stalatin First Nation. David grew up in Stalaco, which is about 150 kilometers west of Prince George. Between 1969 and 1976, David attended the Lajac Residential School in that same area. This residential school operated from 1922 to 1976, and David will be speaking with us today about the 7 years he spent as a student there. Our second guest is Mary Teege. Mary is Gitsan and Carrier from Takla Nation. She is Executive Director of Child and Family Services at Karisikani Family Services here in BC, and is a tireless advocate for Indigenous and women's rights. She sits on the board of the First Nations Child and Family Caring Society, and I'm sure she's happy with yesterday's federal court win by the Society to uphold the Human Rights Tribunal's compensation order directed to First Nations children who were placed in the child welfare system. Mary is also a filmmaker and will be telling us about her new documentary called For Love. The film examines the harms Indigenous children are experiencing in the child welfare system today. It's Mary's second film with director Matt Smiley, with whom she worked on the critically acclaimed Highway of Tears documentary about missing and murdered Indigenous women. And I would be remiss if I did not mention that Mary is also a voice actor. She's the voice of Mary the Bear in the Spirit Bear children's film, which I also highly recommend. And finally, our moderator for today's event is Scott Smith. Scott is a partner with me at Gowling WLG in Vancouver. Scott has a unique practice that sits at the intersection of Indigenous, environmental, energy, and natural resources law. He works closely with clients in Carrier and Sicani territories and with Karisikani Family Services, and he knows David and Mary very well. And before I hand things to Scott, I thought I would invite Mary to lead us in an opening prayer.
Creator, Samogit Laha, I want to thank you for this beautiful day of life you have given us on this very special day. Today, we want to ask for blessings for all the survivors and for all those ones that are hurting because of legacies of colonization and residential school. We want to ask that you give us guidance spiritually, mentally, and emotionally. So when we talk about this very important topic today, that we are saying good words, we are saying good words that is going to heal our members. We're going to ask that you give us awareness and intellect so that we really understand together, collaboratively as partners, what true reconciliation means. Again, Creator, we thank you for this day of life you've given us. And again, we ask for your guidance, all my relations.
So thank you, Mary, for that wonderful prayer. As Paul mentioned, my name is Scott Smith. I'm a partner here at Gowling WLG. On this first anniversary of the National Day for Truth and Reconciliation, it is important for us to reflect back on the many findings of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, which was constituted and created by the Indian Residential Schools Settlement Agreement. The commission made the following findings. For over a century, the central goals of Canada's Indigenous policies were to eliminate Indigenous governments, ignore Indigenous rights, terminate treaties, and through a process of assimilation, cause Indigenous peoples to cease to exist as distinct legal, social, cultural, religious, and racial entities in Canada. Indian residential schools were at the center of this policy. Their objective, and I quote from Sir John A. Macdonald, was to, quote, take the Indian out of the child, end of quote, to solve what at the time was commonly referred to as the Indian problem. The commission went on to find that Canada's actions amounted to a cultural genocide, which it defined as follows. Cultural genocide is the destruction of those structures and practices that allow the group to continue as a group. States that engage in cultural genocide set out to destroy the political and social institutions of the targeted group. Land is seized, and populations are forcibly transferred, and their movements is restricted. Languages are banned. Spiritual leaders are prosecuted. Spiritual practices are forbidden, and objects of spiritual value are confiscated and destroyed. And most significantly to the issue at hand, families are disrupted to prevent the transmission of cultural values and identity from one generation to the next. The commission found that Canada had done all of these things to Indigenous peoples. Canada had asserted control over Indigenous lands. In some cases, Canada forced First Nations to relocate their reserves from prosperous to economically marginal lands. Canada replaced Indigenous governments with band councils, which pursuant to the Indian Act, which it enacted, Canada had the power to override decisions made by those councils and to remove their leaders. Canada denied Indigenous peoples who refused to abandon their identity the right to participate fully in Canadian political, economic, and social life. Canada outlawed spiritual practices, put spiritual leaders in jail, and despicably stole sacred objects. And finally, Canada directly attacked Indigenous families by forcibly removing children from their families and sending them to residential schools. The commission also found that Canada pursued this policy in order to eliminate its legal and financial obligations to Indigenous peoples in Canada and to gain control over their lands and resources. These are the unassailable unimaginable facts of our dark shared history. Something that former Chief Justice McLaughlin described as, quote, the worst stain on Canada's human rights record, end of quote. Unfortunately, Canada continues to do many of these things today. The Commission found that instead of moving towards reconciliation, divisive conflicts have emerged over Indigenous education, child welfare, and justice. I would add something that I see daily in my law practice to that list: the continued denial of Indigenous ownership of their lands, as well as full Indigenous self-government, including inherent lawmaking jurisdiction and authority. So during the panel today, we encourage all of our attendees to ask questions. You can do so by typing them into the question and answer box. Throughout the presentation, we will be selecting some of your questions to ask David and Mary. So without further ado, David, over to you.
Thank you, Scott, and Smith, and thank you, Paul Seaman, for inviting me here to the event. I understand there's quite a few folks on the line, like 1,800 people, and that blows me away, first of all. Secondly, the day that the government finally set aside a day for truth and reconciliation, I think, just personally, I think that my parents would have been pretty proud of that. They would look at that as a victory, whether it be small or big. I think they would have accepted this as a victory, nevertheless. And I think as a survivor myself, that is, I look at it as a victory, and a victory of that the governments are starting to take steps, further steps, to acknowledge the impacts of residential schools. So in my slideshow coming up, I put it together based on my experience there. Paul introduced to you the length, the period in which I attended the residential school. And what I don't purport to say is that I'm speaking for all residential school survivors. Each survivor has their own account. And, this is my account of my experience. And what prompted it was the 215 children that were found in mass graves in Kamloops earlier this year. And so it triggered me in a way that, it made me sad all over again. Then I said, well, I got to do something about it. And because for decades and decades, it was the government's in denial about the whole thing. And today, there's still a measure of denial there. And so my goal in doing this presentation is that I'm at four or five major negotiation tables here with Scott Smith and others, currently finished off litigation, a 10-year litigation battle. I'll get into that a little bit later on, but it prompted me to deliver a presentation to governments that we negotiate with, the different ministries, and the industry folks that we have opposite to us, so that they could begin to learn and understand what has happened to us and what they need to do to help things move along, help help reconcile with us, so that they have a deeper understanding, a firsthand experience of, we're not just a bunch of old guys complaining and bitter, constantly complaining about stuff that happened to us in the past. So then remarkably, we have about seven or eight in our administration, still at an administration, that still work for us. So I think that's resistance right there in action. And their resolve to continue to fight at all different levels to seek recognition and reconciliation with government and industry. So that's a bit of a background of why I'm doing this. And Scott and Paul invited me to do this, and I was happy to do it. And so I'll get into the slideshow now. Paul already covered the years I spent there, so we'll just get right into the slideshow. And I mentioned earlier that the 215 children that were found in a mass grave on the grounds of the former residential school in Kamloops. And at that time, prior to the findings, the official records show that there's only 51 children that were accounted for in terms of dying at the school. And then, of course, since then, since that news broke out, there's approximately 1,300 children that have been, the remains have been identified at various residential schools across Canada. And so they just started the search, and I expect that the search will last many, many years. The final tally will, you know, will not be known for some time. The fact is that there is this happening. And so I mentioned earlier that this made me really sad, and that prompted me to do this presentation. And looking at the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, the TRC initially suggested about 4,100 children died at the former residential schools. And so, of course, looking at the 1,300 number that's to date, that's going to, you know, who knows where that number will land, there's going to be substantially more. And so in Kamloops residential school, we also had five or six Stella Den, five in total, that have attended both schools. So the Jack Indian School residential school and the Kamloops Indian residential school. And those people are Emma Baker, Gus Allen, Lillian Louie, Archie Patrick, and Irene Louie. And so when the news broke out, you know, all of us were grieving and stunned and shocked, as much as we've known before that this is going to happen. When it finally happened, it hit you like a ton of lead. Next. And here are the members that attended both Kamloops and Lujak residential schools. So Lillian Louie, she served as chief from 1978 to 1980. So she was the first female chief, Indian Act elected chief in our community. And in the center photo, there's Gus Allen. He passed in 1979, served on council. He died as a result of alcohol. It's an alcohol-related death. So, you know, in the 70s and 80s and 90s, it was pretty common that our people, as well as other people in the neighboring communities, passed as a result of alcohol-related deaths. Emma Baker, on the right-hand side of the screen, she served on SFN Council, so she's she still lives today. And she's a fluent speaker. Next frame. And carrying on with our community survivors, Archie Patrick, he served as chief in 1986 for our community. He served, just finished serving a term from 2013 to 2020 as chief of Stalaco. And in 1983, he also served as Carrier Sicani Tribal Chief. And then Irene Louie, she recently passed on of health-related complications, but you know, these are survivors, and Archie is fluent in both languages, English and Carrier. He's also a school teacher. So these are the guys and ladies that I looked up in my life that that survive both institutions and manage to live long lives and careers. But that's not the case for every single student that attended Billy Jack Residential School. Next frame. And this is just a Indian Residential School's map of Canada, and on all the dots there, you could see where all the residential schools existed and operated. And I expect that all of those grounds will be searched by ground penetrating radar to find more more remains. And then Paul also mentioned that the era of when Lee Jack Residential School opened, so it's and closed 1922 to 1976. It's located on Highway 16, 1.5 kilometers east of Fraser Lake. And when the news broke out again about the 215, you know, prompted me to look up to see if it were actually genocide, because I didn't actually look it up before. But the Canadian Museum for Human Rights said it was, and many other people do, and institutions do. And so I'm looking at it, yeah, it is what it is, and that's what it was. Many students died in this school, unknown causes, from trying to escape to a variety of health-related reasons, and injuries from the staff, priests and nuns, and that sort of thing. And so with that operation of 1922 and 1976, it created intergenerational trauma. And so that's going to affect and has affected myself, and that means my children and their children. And nobody knows exactly how far they'll extend to, but it will. And so that's, you know, that again makes me feel sad. And so some of us have survived the genocide. Many of our people live short lives because of alcoholism. I mentioned earlier that alcoholism was it was rampant in the 70s and 80s for those of us coming out. And the generation before me, I couldn't figure out myself why they were drinking so much. And only later years that I figured out the reason for that is because what happened here at Lee Jack School and their attendance there. And there was no support. And the only support that there was the bottle, and later on drugs. And there was no mechanism for them to begin a path of healing. And family violence, of course, with alcoholism and suicide. Lots of people that I know just didn't make it out of the 70s. And more in, just didn't make it out of the 1980s either. And so, you know, it's common to have plenty of funerals in the 70s and 80s that, you know, as a younger guy, I couldn't understand at the time. But in reality, even though the operations of Lee Jack was there from 1922 to 1976, there's still other forms of genocide today, and it's not obvious to some. And the way I see it is that it still exists today in our fisheries, because in fisheries, we got blockaded by legislation and policies and procedures by DFO and other provincial ministries. So water diversions, they're taking away you know, our lifeblood. We as Dakesh people, we use and travel the water, and that's what that means. And they take it away, and they begin to begin to kill us. That's the objective. As Scott pulled out a quote from Prime Minister McDonald. Other forms of genocide, land alienation, legislation, past major projects, effluent and pollution, Police brutality, you see that all the time. All that is flows from the residential school framework that Canada built. Next slide. And then the pain and suffering. So in this slide, the Catholic Church had 38 documented deaths at Lee Jack. And that's the school that I attended. And what was common was physical and sexual abuse. It was there all the time. That created also violence within the student body. So in other words, our student body would break off into sort of gangs and we would have fights. And that is sad. So we're not, also we're not permitted to speak our own language. You know, we would be out of line just for doing that. So if you can imagine, if your parents were from Sweden or Germany or France or anywhere in Europe that doesn't speak English, and suddenly their children in school got bar soap stuck in their mouth. That's what happened to us when we spoke our own language. So it was pretty cruel. You know, no other society has done that. So that's, you know, one form of punishment. The white strap were used to discipline students for a variety of different reasons. Sometimes the teacher or the priest would be having a bad day, and that's all it took. Yardsticks were also used to strap students' hands and backside, and also whether it be on the wide side or the narrow side, both sides were used. The teachers and supervisors also punched and kicked students, forced to stand in a corner. So if you're out of line in the teacher's view, they'd force you into the corner. You can go to the bathroom, and you had to stay there all day, just facing the corner. And so some of the students, of course, wet themselves and soiled themselves. And some of them collapsed because they couldn't stand any longer. And then the other form of terrorism, I would call it, is a dog was used to terrorize us. And the dog got better treatment than we did. In 1937, four students tried to escape the Le Jack grounds. And it was minus 20. Their names are there on the second bullet. They were found later on, all frozen to death. But as you see, their clothes there, they were not clothed when they were found, because my understanding is when you get hypothermia and you're close to death, you begin to strip your clothes off. And that's how they're found. They're partially clothed. But the full story of the boys ran away, and why it took nearly a day before anybody started to look for them has never been told. And it's just one more shameful and grim reminder of the incomplete chapter in the history of Canada's residential schools. And in my time there too, it is always pretty common that student body was trying to figure out how to escape. And it is always almost an everyday conversation. Some did, but by that time, the school officials already figured out which routes to expect the students to be traveling, and they were caught within the same day and disciplined, and you know, you wouldn't see them for a few days in the classroom. And so fast forward into Today's what you see on your, maybe your commute to work in the major cities. Maybe folks, your friends visiting you. It's often that the outside world sees us first. For example, the downtown east side Vancouver, you see it in Winnipeg, Toronto, major cities, and that's our people on the streets. A direct result of residential schools. And for you guys on the line, you have to understand that we didn't choose this, that this is a direct result of Canada's policy to eliminate us. And in fact, elimination still exists because this generation and the generation before do populate the downtown east side, and they're subject to all sort of health conditions. They populate the prison community. And so this is what you see. So I guess my message to you is, like, don't judge our people. It's Canada's, you know, Canada did this to us, and you're seeing the results of it today. And then, else in this picture here, so it was 1975 of myself and current chief Robert Michel. We're both survivors of the Jack. And that is Christmas 75, so that is the last Christmas party that we had at Le Jack before it shut down. And then in the photo, the other photo in the cafeteria shot, there's a guy, adult there, Carl Dixon. He's from Seashelt. And so he was one of the good guys. He was a supervisor, and he protected us. And he did a good job. To his right, there's Robert Michel. He's the current chief, and you know, he survived and witnessed and has his own account of his experience there. But I'm not pretending to speak for him. It's like I said earlier, I'm just giving you my account of my experience there. And the food that was served there, typically you'd have you know, beans for a week, a slice of bread on Friday, butter, soup that was horrible. So, you know, we're constantly hungry. And not only that, but with the brutality that happens in there, constantly in a state of anxiety and fear. Kind of fast forward into today. So yesterday marked the 10th year anniversary that Stellaten Psych is filed against Rio Tinto. And then later on, Canada and BC became defendants with Rio Tinto. It's the fourth major Aboriginal rights and title case to make it through Canada's justice system, following the Chilcotin case, which had the decision come down in 2014. I served as a witness at the trial and reviewed at least 110,000 different documents to begin preparing for this trial. 24 hours of discovery by about 15 different lawyers. I spent 3 days at the trial itself last year as a witness for the two bands. Before that as well, I also reviewed the Delgamuukw cross-examination transcripts. So I wanted to prepare myself as best that I could with all available information. And so I wanted to be the best witness that I could for our people. And looking back at the cross-examination transcripts of Delgamuukw, the line of questioning is pretty darn racist by Canada and BC. It was no different in my experience with Rio Tinto, Canada and BC today. So on one hand, Canada and BC say, okay, yeah, we're reconciling with First Nations. But on the other hand, in the court system, nothing has changed. They're still as racist as ever. And the line of questioning was virtually identical in those transcripts versus what we did in Rio Tinto. So there's a direct directive from the Crown, obviously, that still exists to deny our existence. So the way I'm looking at it, you know, I explained to Scott Smith and Paul is that just like us trying to prove electricity exists before we even get to the next stage. Like, how stupid is that? And lastly, the court system is still pretty racist. So the judges here now don't dismiss that stuff. You still have to go through the process of proving you exist. And one little story I'll tell you about this, like, I was in Discovery one day. I text Terry Teachy, who's the regional chief of BC. And there's 15 lawyers behind me. He goes, what are you doing? I said, well, I'm proving I exist. He goes, what do you mean? Well, I'm in Discovery. And he goes, well, just slap them all and see if they feel that. I felt like doing it, but I know I probably would have been charged with assault or something. But anyhow, just a, you know, something a little funny, and how stupid really is, how dumb it is, you know. Obviously, we do exist, and we finished the trial, you know, a few months ago. So 10 years yesterday that we filed on this trial. So another example of legislation and policy, steep hill that we have to climb just to prove that we exist. Genocide. And looking ahead, so a lot of you have seen this, TRC call of action. So what we've used, this slideshow with industry and government to really give them information that covers the four corners of what we think is the four corners of reconciliation. Really objective criteria that we could build upon, and you know, some of the violence is working and some of the negotiators are getting it. We've still got a long ways to go with the different ministries in both British Columbia and in Canada. Next slide. So some of the things that come to mind here, like just personally, some of the events, so the truckers had events in Kamloops, and the Sikh bikers of Canada had a rally for the residential school survivors. And so the way I'm seeing it is that events like this support us survivors with, and it warms my heart. And a warm heart is a healing heart. And so, you know, we're not looking for billions of dollars. I think just the truth is would do for me. And this is stuff that you never learned in high school. And so I guess my pitch to you is that push your school districts to include this in a curriculum. Talk to your children, tell them the truth about it, and talk to your neighbors, talk to your friends. That just because you see the dysfunction on the on the surface doesn't mean that we're bad people. It's because of this, it's not our fault. And then lastly, just going, you know, thinking about the slide of our folks on the street who are having a hard time. Really, anybody who attended any of the residential schools in Canada had one foot in hell from the day they stepped into school, into those institutions. And some of us who survived have both feet in hell. And some of us, you know, it'll take a lifelong healing journey. It's not a switch where you just turn off and everything's good, turn on, everything's good. it doesn't work that way. The scars and the impacts from these schools will always be with me. And unfortunately, more studies show that it'll be with my children, even though they never attended residential schools. So in the quote here, I leave you with, those who do not remember the past are condemned to repeat it. And I'll leave you with that. Thank you, Scott. And thank you, Paul. And thank you all to Gowling's World for listening to me.
So David, if you're okay, maybe we'll take one or two questions from the audience. So there's a question here. What can I do more as a settler? Where do I start to make a difference?
So earlier I mentioned that you could go to your school district, the school board, or however things operate in different provinces, and insist that the truth be told by getting survivors and others to technicians to help survivors to put forward curriculum so that your children will know the truth and that the truth will never be denied again.
Okay. So, David, thank you so much for that and for taking the time today to share your personal experiences at the Jack Residential School. I think we're all greatly indebted to you for that. So next up will be Mary Teege. So Mary's going to make a few remarks, and then after which we're going to get to see the trailer for her new film, For Love. So Mary, over to you.
A few remarks, how much time do I have?
So I would like to acknowledge the rightful owners of this territory that we're standing on. We must do that protocol. Our laws dictate that. I also would like to thank Gowling's, especially Scott Smith and Paul, for inviting me to speak to you about this very important topic in the City of Reconciliation, Vancouver. But before I begin, I would like to, for all of us, I know that your lawyers, that your academics, there's many people on the platform today. I would ask that you put your cell phones down, that you stop writing, that you stop scanning legal briefs, because I know I do it as well. We all multitask in this world, so I would like for you to stop everything as we take a moment of silence to honor and to remember all those that we have lost to residential school starting now. Thank you. Today we're going to be talking about understanding the past to build a better future. And I just wanted to reflect that the past for us is not the past. We're living it every day when we talk about impacts of residential school, and especially then the impacts of colonization. Paul said, my name is Mary Teege. I am Takla Nation. I'm Lach Gibu, I come from the Wolf Clan. My house is Negyep. My hereditary chief's name is Maushim Gibu, which is White Wolf. That's who I am. And what I do is I am the executive director of Child and Family Services for Carrier Sitani Family Services. I am the president of the BC Aboriginal Child Care Society. I am a board member of the First Nations Caring Society of Canada. I represent British Columbia on the National Advisory Committee for Child and Family Service Reform. I do all this work because it has to do with children and the betterment of our children. When we think about this day, the National Day for Truth and Reconciliation, we can never ever forget our children in this, because it's our children that suffered. And I want to acknowledge, and I want to thank my brother here, David, for his story, for sharing that. And it takes a lot of strength, especially a man in David's stature, a man who has been my mentor and my hero. At a very young age, when I first started into politics, I looked to David to advise me and to guide me in a good way. And he did, always saying, Mary, do not swear. And I just want to thank you, David, for sharing your heart. It means so much to us. I want to first start talking about, I always say this, the first impact a residential school or even the impact of colonization is a broken heart. You could imagine back in the day when we lived our life in perfect peace and balance and harmony. Not to say that there weren't wars, but we had balance, we had harmony with the environment, and we lived on our land. We lived on the land where the blood of our chiefs were spilled. We lived on the land where our ancestral stories came from. And so when colonization happened and that first impact, you could imagine the broken hearts that we had when we could no longer go to where we used to live and hunt. And so I think speaking about understanding our past, we have to understand that already with colonization, we're already brokenhearted and not broken spirited, maybe brokenhearted. Our spirit was weakened. And so since then, it was the government's policy to obliterate us as Indigenous people. So we look at the first prime minister, the first founder, if you will, John A. Macdonald, and some of his comments that he made to the House of Commons. When the school is on the reserve, the child lives with its parents who are savages. He is surrounded by savages, and though he may learn to read and write, his habits and training and mode of thought are Indian. He is simply a savage who can read and write. The Indian children should be withdrawn as much as possible from the parental influence, and the only way to do that would be to put them in central training industrial schools where they will acquire the habits and modes of thought of white men. In 1882, Macdonald wrote, I have reason to believe that the agents as a whole are doing all they can by refusing food until the Indians are on the verge of starvation to reduce the expense, in 1882. And then, of course, the Residential School Act, making it mandatory, compulsory for children to be taken away from their parents from 1894 to 1947. So when David says this is not our fault, it is not our fault. And you need to understand that. And I tell parents and grandparents whose children ended up in the welfare system again and again, it's not your fault. I tell the children that are in care that it's not their fault that they're in care, that their parents were too hurt and too sick because of all that has happened to them in residential school, that their parents still love them, but because of the hurt that they've gone through, that they were too sick to take care of their children. It's not their fault. The residential school, as you know, it was a methodical, intentional system to assimilate us, cultural genocide. When we look at where we're at now, we know the high rates of children in care, and I think sometimes people don't see that link, so I will be talking about that link. I just want people to also to know that the government already knew how bad it was in residential school. In 1907, Dr. Bryce, who was one of my heroes, as he was Canada's chief medical health officer, wrote a report that highlighted that around 1,560 children, a quarter of those children in one school died of tuberculosis. He followed some children after that and found that 69% of all those students that went to school after they left school had died within a very short time of leaving school. So when David talks about the alcoholism and the drug abuse, you can see it even started back then. This issue is so... it's so personal to all of us as Indigenous people. And I always say that there's not one Indigenous person in Canada that hasn't been impacted by a residential school because of the loss of human potential. How many of our scholars, how many of our brilliant minds, how many of our men and women that could have succeeded and excelled in what we call the white world didn't get that opportunity because they were abused or because they just simply died. Canada as a whole is weaker because of the residential school. So I would argue that every Canadian suffers from the impacts of residential school as well. We know that Dr. Bryce lobbied the government, lobbied Sir, I don't even want to say Sir, Duncan Campbell Scott, whose department ran the residential school. Of course, Duncan Campbell Scott was the Indian Affairs Deputy Superintendent at the time and knew about this report. And so again, Dr. Bryce wrote the report in 1907, went on and on to try to get change. So 1922, what did Duncan Campbell Scott do? Is they disparaged him. And he suffered professionally because he would not stop advocating. So he is an example of moral courage. He is an example of what we should all do, is that it doesn't matter what happens, you need to advocate for change to make it better. We know that later there were other journals and other reports, like in the 1940s, there was a report done by the Journal of Social Work, I believe, where it showed that 80% of children that were in residential school, 80% of children that were in residential school were there because of poverty issues, because their parents or grandparents didn't have enough to give them. This is not very long ago. Then, of course, in the 1950s, when we look at the what's happening today within child and family services legally, we know that in the Indian Act is silent on child and family, or child welfare, if you will. And so in the 1950s, what happened is that federal jurisdiction for child and families was passed on to the provinces. Shortly after that, there was such an increase in Indigenous children going into care. We now call that the 1960s scoop. And I have to say this again, that past is not the past for us. It's very real. My early memories is I know living like on my street that if we saw a blue car, a blue government car, we all had to run. And I remember just being so scared, running and jumping in the ditch and hiding in case we were taken away. Oftentimes my parents would be talking and they said they got the different children. They got this family's children for no reason. I know, and I called her my auntie. She was a nurse. Her husband worked at the sawmill with my father. She was a nurse. They took care of their kids. Their sons were taken away from them for no good reason. I mean, that's real. That's my life. That's my lived experiences. So it's not something that has happened in the past. I also want to remind everybody those impacts of residential school. David showed the pictures and spoke so poignantly about our people that are on the street and we see them. We know the opioid crisis is because of residential school and the impacts of that. I want to really give you a human example of what we're talking about, and it's a personal story. So I remember when I was just about 8 or 9 years old, and my mother and my father took a couple of my cousins in. I didn't know why, but they took care of them. And then later, my little cousins went back to their parents. But about a year later, my older cousins came back, and they had lost all their children. The ministry, child welfare, had come into my community in Tacklin, flew in. And because everybody was drinking, again, because David talks about it was a trauma, took all those 5 children and went, and they all went into care in different homes. There was a set of twins, 4 years old, that were placed in different homes, for heaven's sakes. This is our lifetime. And so years and years later, the kids are grown up now. And I started working and really looking at the child welfare system, but trying to get youth programming that was going to help our people. I was also working, I also am part of the steering committee for the CEDAR project, which looks at the incidence of HIV, AIDS, hepatitis C, and Indigenous youth using intravenous drugs. That study led me to talk to people that were in jail. And what happened is one of those young men that were in jail, 25 years old, was one of the kids that was ripped away from home. And so when I talked to him, he said that was actually going to be my first documentary, was to look at the rates. And the rates of HIV, AIDS, hepatitis C, and the comparing that to impacts of residential school. So it's the first study of its kind that actually quantifies an impact of residential school. Now, when I talked to my cousin, we'll call him John. So when I talked to John and I said, you know, you're in jail and you want to do this interview, and why is that? And he says, I don't want to happen what happened to me, to my younger brothers or anybody in my family. Now, what he said is that when he left foster care, because they ended up in foster care, my cousins, the older cousins, they fought for them. My parents tried to help them get their five children back, and they never could get their children back. So what happened to my cousins is that they started drinking more and more and more. Now, my two cousins, they went to residential school. They went to residential school and they suffered horrible sexual abuse, physical abuse. And then they had these five children and they did really well for so long. But of course, the demons and the trauma and the hurts came forward and they started drinking to ease their pain. And then that's when they lost their children. But they sobered up for many years and kept trying to get their children. But of course, the system at the time, white is right, and they were better in a white home. And so when later you look at, I'm talking to John, he was one of those children. And he and his brother and sister were actually the younger twins that were separated. So in jail, he said, Mary, what happened to me is that I ended up in foster care and they never took me home. So I really didn't know my people. So when I was 19, I went back home to my home community, but I didn't feel like I belonged there. I didn't really know my people. I didn't really know anything. So I didn't feel like I belonged there. My foster parents were no longer having taken money from me, so they didn't want me either. He said, so my family became the homeless, the prostitutes, and the drug dealers of Prince George. And so he ended up in gangs. So when I talked to him, he was HIV positive and had been using drugs since he was about 17. That story is real. And so he died 2 years later. We know that our people, especially our young people, and their HIV positive die quicker. So he died 2 years later. And I stayed in contact with that family. And then 2 years after he passed away, his younger brother was in the same situation. So that's real. That's what we have to deal with. And that's what a true, so you look at the cycle. Their parents went to residential school. They were abused. They ended up in care. Now one of the girls, her child was in care. We know that's a cycle. So out of those five children, two brothers are dead. One is on the street. One is battling drug addiction. And there's one of the sisters is doing well, but she has a child that's in care. So we know that's a cycle. And that, so that isn't the past. That's now. I think about cultural genocide and how that is what we're going through and what we've gone through. I think about the word reconciliation, and I know in my heart that that is not the right word for us. I understand that we talk about that, but we need to think about what that means. Reconciliation is there's an assumption that there was a conciliatory relationship at one point, that there was a mutually beneficial, respectful, balanced relationship with Canada. We never had that. So if we think about what we need to do, there's other RE words that we need to prioritize. There has to be reparation. When we think about genocide internationally, we think about when there are unjust wars, what happens to that country? They are charged with genocide, with whatever, but there's reparations. We've never had that to the full extent in Canada. There has never been redress. There has not been the respect that we should be given. So how can we reconcile when we don't even have a conciliatory relationship? I think when we look at that, we have to think about where we're gonna go moving forward from this day. And we have to think about how we see things. And I want to give one of the stories, again, a personal story. Years ago, we were having a multicultural dinner in Fort St. James, where I grew up. And this was to raise money for children to be able to go to sports activities and to engage in hockey and whatnot. So we were raising money for this. So we had like this $100 plate back then. That was a lot. It's not like lawyer $1,000 plates, but it was about $100 a plate, which was a lot of money. And so what happened was this logger came up and asked Chief Leonard George, who I absolutely love, and Leonard gave a beautiful talk and said, well, why should we keep paying? You know, we're paying your taxes. We're paying for you guys to do this. Why do we keep having to pay all of this money? I didn't do anything to the Indian people. So Chief Leonard George, the beautiful man, so eloquently asked, he goes, are you asking why you should pay for the sins of your father? And the guy says, of course, yeah, why should I? And he says, maybe the question should be, why should you benefit from the sins of your father? So we have to think moving forward, what do we need to do? We understand where we've come from. And David, so again, that basic humanity is to understand and to be aware when you see our people on the street, to be human and to understand and to help, to listen to the stories of Indigenous people that have gone through all the atrocities that we have. I just want to acknowledge the work of Scott and Paul on this journey to getting to federal enabling legislation. When I asked them to help me, and both Paul and Scott, especially Scott, is like, no, it's not enough money. I'm just kidding. Scott said, this is not his thing. Like, child welfare is not my expertise. But what I said is that, well, think about it this way. Our children are our most important resource. So with the way that you fight for forestry, Indigenous rights, mining, water, is the same way we need to fight for our children. And so we went through this journey together. And I just wanted to commend them because through that, we actually drafted a federal enabling legislation pre-C92. We went across Canada. We listened to the advisors at the National Advisory Committee for Child and Family Service Reform, some of the best best minds in child and family services. And we drafted a beautiful act, which Scott named the Family or First Nations Family Caring Act. We then end up with C92. Which again, it's a way for us to develop our own child and family services, our own child and family laws. And I think that's really important. I need to say this, that there's a misconception that jurisdiction was given to us for child and family, but it wasn't. I would argue that we've always had jurisdiction. What we didn't have was the resources to breathe life into our own laws. And that's where we need to get to. What we need to do together is that we need all of the influencers, the people that have the ear of government, to push and to advocate for fundamental change. It's not gonna be cheap. Reconciliation isn't a cost neutral process. There's monies involved. There is the movement that we need to ensure that we are truly the decision makers when it comes to our resources. That the children that we're taking care of now, that when they are grown up, that they are going to be true leaders of their own land. And when they step on that land, they know that they're the ones that are going to make that decision on that territory. That's what we need to strive to. I also know that what we need to do is to push the MPs and the MLAs to implement the Spirit Bear Plan. And if you go on the IamAWitness.com, you'll see the First Nations Caring Society. We have a plan for the government so that to end inequity and discrimination for First Nations children. I often think, before I'm just wrapping up here, that I think about what my mom says. She says, we are like salmon, we always go home to die, and that's our right. I think about the 215, and I think about all those unmarked graves, where they never got even the basic human dignity to be buried in their homelands. And so that's real today. And I want to leave you with the words of a young man. When I started the youth program all those years ago for Carriage County Family Services, I asked youth what their dreams were. Many of them dreamt about becoming a lawyer, becoming a doctor, being an actor. But this one young man came up and said, I dream of a day when I only have to read about the impacts of residential school, not have to live it. It is incumbent on all of us to make this dream a reality. We must do this for our children. We must do this for love. Masai.
So thank you very much, Mary, and probably a fitting end with your comments for love. So now if we could go to the trailer of your documentary for love, that'll be about a couple minutes, and then we get to ask Mary some questions about making the movie. So without further ado, over to the trailer, please.
I always tell them, speak your mother tongue, I said. Because you, like, if we lose it, Chinese can go to China and learn it. French can go to France. Where do we go? This is it. We can't go home. This is home. And I said, once we lose our language, then we're white.
How do you say, I love you? Again. Again. Again.
Indigenous children are vastly, disproportionately overrepresented in the child welfare system.
I'm constantly afraid. Even if I know I'm doing the right things, I still am constantly afraid of the fear that someone could even take my kid.
All these kids that I paddle with, we're all kids in care, so we barely know who we are and we don't know where we come from and where our roots are. And then just that little bit of information, we can travel way back to our ancestors and we can figure out who we are.
This is about co-creating a society where every kid counts, every kid is worth the money, and where everyone's differences are not overcome, but they're celebrated.
We've got to recognize that this is not a one-shot and then you think about something else. But the important thing is to make sure that, in fact, we continue to progress.
I feel like the more you know what's going on with other people, the more we can relate and the more we can help each other.
To be proud, you have to be proud of where you've been and who you are. You can't forget that.
So I feel like we're on weekend update here at this panel setting. So now's the time, Mary, I get to ask you a few questions about For Love, which of course premieres tonight in Vancouver. So how did the film come to be?
So I was asked about our prevention services at Red Carrington County Family Services. We had the culture camp. We developed our own family law model. We did a lot of work without receiving prevention dollars. So what happened, of course, is that we won the Canadian Human Rights Tribunal ruling when Canada was proven to be discriminatory against First Nations children, and they were ordered for the first time ever to pay for prevention costs. Prior to that, Canada paid for children to stay in care, but not to prevent them going into care. So there was an opportunity to showcase all prevention activities across Canada, and especially really the messaging that the culture was prevention, culture is medicine. And so I was asked, working with Indigenous Service Canada, and so I said, I want to have full artistic control, and I also get to choose my director, and that's what happened. So I said, submitted a proposal, said this is what I wanted the film to be, but I really wanted to ensure that at the end of the day that our children would watch this film that were in care and understand that they were loved, understand that they belong to a culture and really have a feeling of hope.
And so I understand that you and Matt Smiley, who is the director and executive producer of the film with you, went all across Canada and conducted a number of interviews. So what was the most memorable thing that you observed in that process?
I think the most memorable thing that I observed was that the resilience and the strength of children and of our families, and how we're still here, and how, regardless of how we were portrayed in the media and all the atrocities that have happened, that we still could just so exuberant, just be so sparkly with who we are as Indigenous people. And I think that was beautiful. And it didn't matter where we were, whether or not it was an Attawapiskat where we couldn't really take a shower, drink the water, where it was just, you know, overcrowding and housing. You just saw the beauty and the resilience and the strength of our people. I think that was so remarkable.
Yeah, and I think that leads me into my next question is, what would you like people to take away from the movie?
I think Canadians generally, and this is why I really wanted it to be international in scope, so people that were aware that, again, it's not our people's fault, that, you know, the child welfare system was something that was put onto us, that our children were ripped away from us, and that even with that, we still have a strong, vibrant culture. But more importantly, I also need Canadians and the world to know that we are still suffering the impacts of residential school, and we have a long way till we can sleep at night because there's still abject poverty in our communities. There's still the abuses. There's still the lack of mental health resources in our community. We still need a lot to do as a society to ensure that every child has equity, and we're not there yet.
So today is a special day, for National Truth and Reconciliation Day. And you decided to launch your movie today. Why was that?
I think it's a really good way to commemorate this day. And it's really a film for the survivors on this day. An acknowledgement of the hurts that they suffered, and just to celebrate the resilience of our survivors and to show the world our children being attacked and taken away is a direct impact of residential school, but also to show how together with as culture is our foundation, that we must move together so that we, as a young boy said, that we would never have to feel and live the impacts of residential school again.
And how do you feel that the movie contributes to our dialogue on truth and reconciliation?
I think it's important because, again, as I said earlier, you know, we really have to consider what are we talking about when we're talking about reconciliation, that it's not something that you can just talk about it and wear an orange shirt on the day, but you actually have to take action. You actually have to do something. But also I think it's just having that understanding and awareness of why we're at where we're at. Understand why we have such a high rates of children in care. It's not that we're just bad parents, but because we were ripped away, not parented when you went to residential school. Like, that's the reason why our children are in care. And also because it's a system of governance. Child welfare is a non-Indigenous system of governance. It's white man laws that have perpetuated the cycle of having children going into care. So I think when we think about truth and reconciliation, that, you know, there's so many things you need to do. As I said, urge your MPs and your MLAs to make fundamental change. Urge them to stop taking us to court. Like, for heaven's sakes, we're in court again. We're going to be in court again. We have another judicial review, and I think people don't realize this, but Trudeau, when he got into this next election, when he got in this last time, a few weeks ago, one of the first acts he did is that we have another judicial review for the CHRT orders, and that's denying us funding for capital. So one of the issues, as you know, for children going into care are those structural interventions, issues of poverty, things that are beyond their control. And housing is huge in our communities. And so the CHRT ruled that capital should be an expense, or that it should be funded at actual cost. And now that's up for judicial review. So
I'm going to go into a little bit lighter subject matter now. So Shania Twain, everybody's talking about her and her role as the narrator in the movie. Why did you and Matt pick Shania to narrate the movie?
Well, I hang with Shania all the time. No, I'm just kidding. No, I think, because her story itself, I wanted a woman for sure. I definitely wanted a female narrator, and I wanted somebody that was international in scope. I could pretend and say that I'm really famous and have a very famous voice because I'm Spirit the Bear, but it wasn't going to get me further outside of Canada. But so we wanted somebody really international, but I also wanted somebody that understood the issues, and she definitely does. As you know, her stepfather, but she calls him as her father, was Indigenous and adopted her when she was 2 years old. And so she went through such difficult times. And then when her parents passed away, she actually raised her brothers. And it could have been different. Those brothers could have been ended up in care. And so all the work that she does is advocating for youth. And as I said, she has Shania Kids Can group, and she raises money, or she gives money, a lot of money. And so it just seems so appropriate.
So one final question, Mary, before I turn to make some closing remarks. So premieres tonight, what's next for the movie?
We're going to be screening in possibly in Ottawa and Montreal, and then we screen in LA in November, and then we just have the film festivals.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Well, thank you for that.
You're welcome.
So a few closing remarks from me before I turn the podium back over to our Indigenous practice group leader, Paul Seaman. So first and foremost, I'd like to thank David and Mary for their excellent presentations today. It was extremely generous of you to share some of your time with us on this first National Day for Truth and Reconciliation. You're both very good, close, personal friends of mine, and I know I approached you and asked you to do this, and I'm just so grateful that we could share your stories and your experiences with almost 1,700 people today. Wow, what an audience. And so I think I can speak on behalf of everybody that we're extremely grateful for everything that you shared with us today. So thank you very much. I'd like to conclude our panel today with a few remarks on the issue of Aboriginal title. This is something that Paul touched upon in his land acknowledgement when he recognized that we are on the unceded, unsurrendered Aboriginal title lands of the Musqueam, Squamish, and Tsleil-Waututh people. All of the history and current problems that we have heard about today affecting Indigenous people have a common cause. The intentional and thorough disruption of Indigenous legal orders and systems of governance when the Crown asserted sovereignty over what is now known as Canada. The Supreme Court of Canada has recognized in its leading cases on Aboriginal title that, firstly, Canada's claim to sovereignty is based entirely on a unilateral assertion by the Crown that it is sovereign over this territory or country. And secondly, the Crown's assertion caused the title to all those lands to vest in the Crown. The Crown asserted sovereignty at a time when Indigenous people outnumbered settler populations. In the leading case of Haida Nation, the Supreme Court of Canada held that First Nations had never been conquered, many First Nations had not surrendered their rights through treaties, and their rights had not been extinguished. All of this raises the fundamental question of how Canada came to control the lands that we now know as the Canadian territory. Many of us today on the panel and in the audience are lawyers. As lawyers, we should feel compelled to scrutinize this reasoning that the Crown's mere assertion of sovereignty and the subsequent de facto control it achieved much later on as a result of its policies of cultural genocide, the very things that David and Mary spoke to us about today, could have such an effect, especially now on this first day of the National Day of Truth and Reconciliation, and in the learning that we've done today about the deep damage that was caused by this cultural genocide. And we heard from David and Mary that cultural genocide continues. Legal scholar John Burroughs and others have made this case in academic commentary. And I'm going to leave you with one final thought. My suggestion to you today is that we must question exactly what legal effect the Crown's unilateral declaration had or did not have in Canada. Doing so will help us reimagine a new constitutional landscape, one in which Indigenous governments can reassume their inherent jurisdiction and lawmaking authority within the Canadian polity. So Mary talked about this. It's not about the Crown granting Indigenous people jurisdiction. It's about inherent jurisdiction and lawmaking authority that has always existed. Since time out of mind, or as our friends from Tsleil-Waututh would say, time immemorial. I submit to you that doing so would form the basis of a more just, fair, equitable, and inclusive society, one truly based on the rule of law, not just Crown law, but the many Indigenous legal orders and systems that continue to exist across Canada. I submit to you that reimagining such a new constitutional landscape in Canada will help us forge together a true path forward in reconciliation. So with those remarks, I'd like to thank everybody for joining us, and I'll pass the podium over to my good friend and partner, Paul Seaman. Thank you.
Thanks, Scott, and thanks so much. Let me add my thanks, sincere thanks to David and Mary for being with us here today and agreeing to share your stories and your insights with all of us. I think it's been a powerful, a moving discussion, and a very good way for us to commemorate Canada's first National Day for Truth and Reconciliation. And together, I hope we've helped each other put into action calls to action number 80 and 92. And as Scott briefly mentioned, Gowling WLG is sponsoring the world premiere of For Love, Mary's new film. And we're very proud to be supporting the production and the promotion of this very important film. And so as part of our sponsorship, we'll be sending all of you who've attended today a link to access an exclusive on-demand screening of For Love. So you should receive a message from Gowling WLG within the next 24 hours, and the film will be available to stream until end of day, Sunday, October the 3rd. So please watch for that. And there'll be an opportunity as well to donate when you screen the film. So please watch for that too. But let me close by thanking you for attending our Learning and Legacy event. Our hope is that it'll help all of us reflect on the path towards reconciliation and what that means for all of us. Thank you again.